Blackstone Publishing presents Firefly, Life Signs by James Lovegrove. This book is read by James Anderson Foster. Dedicated to Cat Camacho for keeping us flying. I have clinched and closed with the naked north. I have learned to defy and defend. Shoulder to shoulder, we have fought it out, yet the wild must win in the end. Robert W. Service, The Heart of the Sourdough. When a battle seems unwinnable, a soldier has two choices, to fight on or to accept the inevitable. Often, the two are hard to tell apart. Browncoat General William Hubert Cole, discussing the Battle of Serenity Valley. Author's note. The events in this novel take place between the Firefly TV series and the movie Serenity. 1.
You know, you got one of them upside-down faces.
Huh?
An upside-down face. You know what I mean.
Don't reckon as I do.
Bald on top, neck beard below. You stand on your head, it'd look like your face was the right way up.
You trying to be funny?
Merely tendering an observation. Of course, from my current perspective, your face is the right way up.
You're about to die. I really don't think this is the time to be making wisecracks.
Personally, can't think of a better time to be making wisecracks than when you're about to die. The two men speaking were Malcolm Reynolds, Firefly Captain, former Browncoat, Buccaneering Rogue, and one Desmond Rouleau, Killer for Hire. The former was bound hand and foot and hanging by his ankles from a bough of a tall mesquite. The latter was standing in front of him, brandishing a hunting knife with a 12-inch blade. It was night. Cicadas were singing. A trio of moons illuminated the scene, as did the headlights of a 2-seater hover gig parked nearby. A couple of hours earlier, the pair had had an arranged meet in a cabin in the woods, a mile outside a town called Lonesome Rock. This was on Odessa, a rim world that lay a hop, skip, and a jump from the Ouroboros asteroid belt. There'd been the prospect of a job, some cargo to transport, paid work, something which had been pretty thin on the ground lately for Mal and his crew. A condition for the rendezvous had been that Mal came alone, no sidekick, no backup. Rouleau didn't want to fuss. He was a low-key kind of guy, he'd said. They would talk, man to man.
Get a person on their own some, look them in the eye, and take the measure of them. That's how Desmond Rouleau operates.
Shots of bourbon were downed. A deal was sealed with a handshake. All at once, Mal felt woozy, like he was descending 100 floors in an express elevator. He got up from the table, fumbling for his gun, and keeled over flat on his face, unconscious. When his senses returned, he found he had been strung up from the mesquite and was dangling there like a human piñata. That was bad. Worse, perhaps, was the fact that his eyes were more or less level with Desmond Rouleau's crotch. There were pale, crusty stains on the front of the man's pants, and Mal didn't much care to know where they'd come from. Food grease, he hoped.
"Now then, Mr. Reynolds," said Desmond Rouleau, "I bet you're wondering why you're here all trussed up and no place to go."
Thought had crossed my mind. The blood was pooling in Mal's head. His face felt puffy, swollen, his temples throbbed, and his sinuses ached.
"I'm guessing you didn't slip a sedative into my drink and drag me all the way out into the boondocks and drape me from a tree just to discuss, I don't know, philosophy.
Unless you have, in which case I apologize for misreading the situation. It's just, you don't look the philosophy type."
"You're here," Rouleau said in the tone of someone whose patience was being sorely tested, "to die. Can't put it any plainer than that."
Would have been my second guess. Not discussing philosophy, then dying. It's normally one or the other.
"Want to know why you're going to die?
Be strange if I weren't a teeny bit curious."
Rouleau squatted down so that they were nose to nose. This was better than being nose to crotch, in visual terms at least. Unfortunately, Rouleau had terrible teeth and halitosis to match.
"'Cause you pissed off a rich, powerful man," he said, "and he wants some payback."
"Huh. That's all you got to say? Huh? Well, thing is,
I've pissed off a fair few people in my time, rich folks among them.
Rouleau nodded sagely. Even though I ain't but known you an hour or so, I can see how that might be possible.
So you're gonna have to narrow it down for me, Mal said.
Who?
Name Durin Hamer mean anything?
Durin Hamer, sometime bioweapons expert, wealthier than God, avid collector of Earth that was artifacts, had been the owner of a rare antique laser pistol, the Lassiter, until said weapon found its way into Mal's hands through a complex chain of circumstances, which began with an encounter with an old browncoat friend called Monty, and ended with Mal marooned in the desert bare-ass naked.
Never heard of him, Mal said.
Funny, because he definitely knows you, said Rouleau. Says you took something from him, something he prized greatly.
Oh, that Durin Hamer.
Yeah.
Come to think about it, I did maybe help relieve him of a certain gun.
Gun? Rouleau chuckled mirthlessly. Nobody's mentioned any gun. No, what you took from Mr. Hamer was way more valuable.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.